then we're going to have to talk about the problems that actually exist, the institutional racism itself. In the labor market, white males with a high school diploma just as likely to have a job as black or Latino males with a college degree. And even when you control for age and education and years of experience and geographic location, on average, blacks and Latinos and indigenous persons earn anywhere from 10 to 25% less than similarly qualified or oftentimes even less qualified white males. In the area of education, even when people of color, black and Latino children in particular, even when they take that eighth grade achievement test that we all take right before we go into high school, and that's the test we take that sort of determines like what classes are we going to be put in, you know, when we get to ninth grade and 10th grade, and it's used as a way to track and to sort, you know, supposedly on the basis of ability, which tracking is not really about, that never has been. When we take those tests, even when black and Latino students score at the top of the distribution, so even when black and Latino students do very well using the biased and absurd indicators that we use in this country, they're still 40% less likely to be put into an advanced placement class or an honors class in high school than white students who scored in the middle of the distribution. So you have average white students, according to this criteria, and of course the criteria is bogus, but understand it's the one we use. Using this criteria, white students who are merely average are still more likely to have advanced or accelerated classes once they get to high school. Now, what does that mean? It means that those students are going to get more prepared for the SAT, right? They're going to get more prepared for the ACT. They're going to take the test, and they're going to do better. And we're going to act shocked when people of color do worse on a test that they were systemically excluded from preparing for, as if that is a surprise. I mean, black and Latino students of whatever socioeconomic status, 2.5 times more likely than whites to be put into remedial classes, where they're not going to receive the same instruction, they're not going to have the same coursework, they're not going to be challenged in the same way, right? And so we then act surprised when in 11th grade they take the SAT, the ACT, they don't do as well, and then our society says, what? Well, now you're not capable of going on to college, or at least not that college, because you're not as smart as somebody else over here. The fact that the structure of the educational system guaranteed that you would not do as well, virtually assured it, is something we don't want to talk about. But that's the systemic issue. And Perini talked about it last night. We have a society that doesn't want everybody to get a college education. It's not functional for everyone. I mean, if everyone gets a college degree, who's going to sweep the floors, right? Who's going to clean the streets? Who's going to empty the bedpans in the hotels of this country? Who's going to do that work? Who's going to pick strawberries from dawn to dusk as migrant labor if everybody has access to a college degree, if everybody has access to a job? We don't have a society where we really want everybody to have a job. That's why the Federal Reserve raises interest rates whenever unemployment drops too low. What does that mean? Unemployment is too low. Now, how is that? I mean, people are out of work, but that's good. If you're Alan Greenspan, that's good. So if unemployment drops below, let's say, 4%, oh my God, we got to do something. We got to stop that. Stop all that hiring. Jesus, stop hiring people. So how do we stop hiring people? Well, we can't force them, but we can raise the interest rates. We'll increase the cost of borrowing money, right, to expand your business. That'll stop you from hiring. If we do it once and it doesn't stop you, we'll do it again, and we'll do it again, and we'll do it again. And pretty soon, what do you know? The hiring spree does stop, and we sort of settle in at 4%, 4.5% unemployment, which really isn't 4% or 4.5% unemployment. It's really more like 9%, because the people aren't counted who have just given up and stopped looking for work. The people aren't counted who are in prison or in jail. If you were to add all these folks into the unemployment numbers, it would be about double what it really is. So we're looking at maybe 8%, 9%, maybe 10%, which translates to about 10 to 12 million people at any given moment out of work, even when the economy is at full employment. So you have 10 to 12 million people out of work, not because they're lazy, certainly not because, as the bell curve says, their genes and DNA are messed up, but instead because we have a system that says that many people must be unemployed to keep inflation low. That's the logic, because if too many people are working, my God, workers will have more power, they'll push for higher wages, oh God forbid that would happen, then prices would go up, milk might cost $2.50 a gallon, of course the fact that people had work and could pay for that, you know, never seems to enter anybody's mind, but we don't want the prices to go up, so we keep unemployment relatively high, we have 10 to 12 million people out of work because our society makes that necessary, and of course that has a class component, also has a race component, because it's not functional to have those 10 to 12 million people be mostly white. That would not do, you see, because if you had that many people who were of the dominant racial group, who were the ones out of work, right, the ones who by virtue of being out of work would then be poor, right, the disproportionate numbers of people who were poor then having to receive some form of public assistance, that little bit that still exists, if those numbers were disproportionately in the white community, Well, that would not be acceptable to the vast majority of that community, and so something would be done about it. So we can't allow that. We have to make that system not only one that hurts people at the bottom of the economic ladder, but that hurts those who are most disempowered racially as well. So the persons who end up having to be victimized, not because of some conspiracy. You don't have to sit down and conspire to have this happen. It's autopilot. It just makes sense. It's just functional for that many people to be out of work to keep the economy strong in the eyes of those who own property and need it to be at a certain level. And also it's functional to have those folks that are mostly harmed by it be people of color because their political power is less. But our responses to this, pushing for diversity and nothing more than that, is simply not enough. We're going to have to talk about these bigger and deeper issues. We're going to have to understand why inequity persists. Just as Michael Perini talked about last night, these things are not accidental. It's very functional to have certain groups of the population viewed as surplus people. So if you go back to the history of slavery in this country, it was very functional to have certain people as surplus. And then when slavery ended, you had this wide array of black persons who were no longer functional to the economy of the South. They were now surplus people. So they had to move where? They moved north. And then as the industries began to move into the suburbs or move now overseas to take advantage of lower or non-existent labor laws, lower or non-existent environmental protection laws, they become surplus once again. Now what do you do with them? Well, you got to lock them up now. I mean, there's very little else you can do at that point. You can either, you know, you could send them away, you could repatriate them, but there's not, at this point, enough support for that, thank God. But you can still lock them up. You can internally colonize, right? And so this mechanism of social control, it's not merely an economic function. Sort of traditional Marxism would argue that, you know, racism is simply some edifice of the class system, that if we just get rid of the class system, you know, or begin to talk about class, that racism would go away. I would suggest it's a little bit more complicated than that, although there is certainly an economic functionality to having people of color be surplus population, because if you have surplus labor, it drives down the wages of all working people. You know, we understand that. But it's more than that. I mean, the criminal justice system functions as a mechanism of social control above and beyond the economy. So to have people of color being disproportionately locked up doesn't just, I mean, it, you know, it's good for the economy in the sense of the image, because those people don't get counted as unemployed, so we look like we're a much stronger and healthier economy, you know, than we are. But also it's a mechanism of social control by use of fear, because if white people see that people of color are the ones disproportionately being marched off to prison and to jail, and if people of color see that as well, what's the result of that? I mean, we live in a society that sort of, you know, has this myth of individualism where wherever you end up on the ladder of life, it's all about you, right? So if you worked really hard, you'll get up here, and you certainly wouldn't go to jail. If you end up down here or in prison, you know, you obviously didn't work as hard. Maybe your DNA was messed up. Your cultural values were bad. So when people see, you know, white folks at the top of the hierarchy, people of color at the bottom, and people of color disproportionately locked up, what's the sort of logical conclusion that someone would come to if they weren't thinking critically? They would come to the conclusion that those people being locked up must be the dangerous people. Because why else would we be locking them up? They must be the folks we need to fear. Those are the people we don't want in our neighborhood. Those are the people we don't want in our children's school. Those are the people we don't want our children hanging out with, right? Those are the people we don't want in the job, in the company that we work for, because we know there's something wrong with them, because look, all these people are being marched off to prison. So it's a mechanism of control that then allows the system of racism and inequality to be maintained, because the dominant group, even people who themselves are not taught to be racist, even those of us who are white and don't have this sort of overt racial bias, we're still bombarded by these images of who the dangerous folk are, who the failures are in the economy. And unless we have an understanding of the systemic functions of the economy and polity that results in this inequity, we're going to come to this conclusion, even if we're not overtly hateful people, even if we would never join the Klan or a skinhead group or anything like that, we still might very well, or at least enough of us, might come to the conclusion that those are the folks to watch out for. And as long as we're thinking that, that keeps us in line. Because if we're looking out for the danger that comes in black or brown skin, what are we not paying any attention to? We're not paying attention to the damage that corporations do. We're certainly not paying attention to the skin color of the people who make the decisions in those corporations. So we don't call that white crime. What do we call it? White collar crime. Right? But the collar is rarely the only thing lacking color. I mean, normally there is more than just that, right? The term white crime, I mean, doesn't even resonate. You know, when did you ever hear that? When have you ever heard anybody talk about the white crime problem? You don't. But every time there is an increase in the crime rate in a black or brown community, particularly a poor community, there is this discussion that gets played out. What is wrong with the black family? Like there's only one black family, and if we can just figure out what the hell's wrong with them, everything will be fine, right? Now, when Charles Manson and John Wayne Gacy and Jeffrey Dahmer and, thank you very much, and Ted Bundy do what they do, nobody asks what it is about white people that makes them consume human flesh, bury 25 people under the house.